Welcome to another show of this week. Late Friday on September 23rd, South Sudan's first Vice President Taban Deng-Gai assured the General Assembly that the South Sudanese government has consented to provisions of the Security Council Resolution 2304, which authorizes an expanded peacekeeping force to bolster civilian protection.
Addressing the General Assembly, Taban Deng said the implementation of the resolution was being discussed by various parties.
I want to assure the August House that our government has consented to the UN Security Council Resolution 2304, 2016, and its implementation is being discussed by and with UN, by us and UN and UNMISS, Transitional Government of National Unity, the region. My government position is that we have to engage more with UN on the details pertaining to the implementation of this resolution. This is in order to avoid drilling national healing and reconciliation.
The first vice president said external intervention often affects negatively internal reconciliation, but insisted that South Sudan will cooperate with UNMISS, the regional bodies, towards the recovery of his country.
The Republic of South Sudan will cooperate with UNMISS, the regional bodies, IGAD, EAC, AU, Troika, EU, and all our friends in a journey towards recovery from the tragedy that befall us. We promise to bring peace, justice, rebuild a strong and credible institution in our country. It is our plan to move the country forward on its major developmental projects, roads, bridges, new cities, power, education, health, modernized agriculture, so that we can feed our people. We are going to commit our endowed resources from oil, mineral, human resource, etc., for the development of the youngest nation in the world.
Speaking previously after a high-level meeting on South Sudan, UN peacekeeping chief Javier Latsous said the UN was in contact with South Sudan on issues of the regional protection force.
We are in contact with them about the regional protection force. We're trying to elucidate a number of points that were raised by somewhat contradictory, maybe, statements from Juba, but we are watching this very closely, and you may be sure that the Security Council is indeed watching very, very closely, because they expect, and I think it was said so, that the government of South Sudan does uphold the commitments it made in that joint communique. When you agree to something, you have to live to your promises.
Co-regional and international parties of the South Sudan peace process held various meetings on the sidelines of the 71st UN General Assembly to exchange views on how best to advise the political process and to create the required political conditions for the successful implementation of the United Nations mission in South Sudan mandate, with the participants urging the transitional government of national unity to cooperate fully and without further delay on the deployment of the UNMISS Regional Protection Force.
Up next, the chairperson of the Union of Journalists of South Sudan, Oliver Modi, is calling for dialogue between the media and the state to discuss issues of press freedom. He was speaking to David Lucan on Radio Mirai's Democracy in Action program, which airs every Monday morning just after the 9 a.m. news.
The journalists in the Republic of South Sudan thought wisely, establish a vibrant media, a pluralistic media, an independent media in the Republic of South Sudan. And that media was actually taught to promote democracy, freedom of expression, the right to access to information, and the development in the Republic of South Sudan at large. We started by coming up with the including the media in the transitional constitution of the Republic of South Sudan. And that was very clearly defined in Article 24 and so. So, as if this is not enough, we backed up this constitution, the transitional constitution, by establishing or producing media laws in the country to also add to whatever laws we have in this country. And I think the media laws include the Public Broadcasting Corporation law now, and then the right to access to information, and then the media authority. We have reached a point of having those laws and make sure that the legal procedures and the legal structures must be made functional in order to deal with the individuals as well as the journalists themselves. So that at the end of the day, it is not you and me or that person outside there that decides for who is wrong and who is right. It is the law that's supposed to decide for who is right. The media in the Republic of South Sudan is interfered by individual interests. And these individual interests can be ducked back to all the crises that happened, say for example, in as it started from December 15 all the way to this time, that we are working as journalists in a conflict environment. And once you are working in a conflict environment as journalists, many things are not going to according to the law. This misunderstanding between us and some individuals, we have to turn to make dialogue. Like for example, the security in the beginning. The security sector has a problem with the media as well as the media houses, the editors, the managers, and then the journalists. So what we do is that, okay, what is the problem? So in this case, we said the only solution is to have a dialogue. And we started this dialogue since 2011. We moved with that dialogue all the way to 2013. If this crisis would have not arisen in the country, we would have by this time settled most of our differences and make sure that we work in peaceful coexistence. We have put some steps ahead with our security and even with the government. I think, as I said, if not because of the crisis that happened in the middle here, we have done our best in order to make sure that we know our differences. We have actually identified them, and we find a solution. We have found a solution for those differences, and even we reached to extent of forming a committee between the journalists and the security. We have a committee that actually includes the Minister of Information, and to make sure that some of those differences we need to implement. I mean, those solutions that we have agreed upon to be implemented, so that journalists now can be able to operate freely in the Republic of South Sudan. We went to all the then 10 states of the Republic of South Sudan and make sure that we created this understanding between us and so on. So, and by the way, this dialogue continues. We are currently using this dialogue in order to solve some of our issues. We need to continue writing and balance our informations, whatever the case is, both political, political, economic, and social. This one is by law, is not denied for any journalist, for any opinion writer, for whoever wants to write.
In our next piece, we shed light on a two-day dialogue on women, peace, and security, which addressed various issues around impunity on sexual and gender-based violence in South Sudan. Here is the story. The government, UN agencies and various stakeholders have ended a national dialogue in the capital, Juba, to discuss issues of impunity on sexual and gender-based violence in South Sudan. After the country's crisis in July, the Ministry of Gender, Child and Social Welfare say they are working on strengthening the implementation of the 2015 to 2020 National Action Plan, which was launched in 2015 on the UN Security Council Resolution 1325 on women, peace and security, and other related resolutions. The objectives of the National Action Plan include the protection of women and girls, including those with disabilities, against any form of sexual and gender-based violence, respect for human rights, human dignity and equality, working on enabling peace and security stakeholders, and increasing women's participation in the prevention and resolution of conflicts, among other objectives. Speaking at the end of the two-day dialogue which looked at responses of the government to address impunity on gender-based violence and support survivors, Rachel Nyadak, the presidential advisor on gender and human rights, said the country must protect women so as to end violence against them.
All national legislation and other action to combat violence against women should be in line with international standard. We also know that culture and religion can never be invoked to justify violence against women and girls. We have broken the silence, and the country has put many laws, policies, and programs in place.
An official from the United Nations Development Programme highlighted some issues.
One key highlight was that essentially there appears to be a reactive mode to gender-based violence, but what the action plan is advocating for is more of a preventive and a protective mode. So essentially all the issues, you know, come around peace and reconciliation, trauma and healing in relation to women, the intersection of human rights with the customary norms and values, and how all this can be married together to be able to have action points and implement this national action plan.
Esther Ikere, the Undersecretary in the Ministry of Gender, Child and Social Welfare, said South Sudan, as a member of the United Nations, is obliged to implement the Security Council Resolution 1325.
We have some weak institutions that may need institutional reform. We also need the security sector particularly to be reformed. We need the strengthening of the judiciary and the justice system, the criminal justice system in general. And we also need to create a lot of awareness and sensitization to our people. So we need to break the culture of violence. We need to break the culture of silence to ensure that people also come and report on these cases that are taking place.
South Sudan's women have suffered numerous forms of violence, and it was recognized that partnerships between government institutions and non-governmental organizations was key, with the judiciary, academia, media, and religious organs, among others, weighing in to help end violence. At a one-day workshop on Thursday, South Sudan's army called for mutual trust between the army and civilians. We interviewed workshop participants, and this is what they had to say. An organization calling itself the Voluntary Civil Society Task Force on Implementation of the Peace Agreement 2015 has called a workshop and have invited representatives from different departments of the military. They say that they recognize the critical role the military has in promoting peace, stability, and protection of the civil population in South Sudan. Speaking on the sidelines of the workshop, the Director of Moral Orientation at the SPLA headquarters called for mutual trust between the army and civilians.
This workshop will show the people of South Sudan that the SPLA has a responsibility on the civilian. As I said before, that the army were a civilian first, they were coming from the civilian, and they work until they will return to the civilian. So they should have a good relationship with the civilians, because it is where they originated from and the place they will return to.
The workshop is being conducted under the theme Confidence and Trust Building Between the Army and Civil Population, and an official of the task force explained this.
Today's workshop is organized by the Voluntary Civil Society Task Force on Implementation of the Agreement, but specifically for the institution of the military. So in this workshop, we are having representatives from different institutions within the Army. The intention of the workshop, the theme of the workshop, is to enhance the relationship between the institution of military and the civil population. And we're doing that because we feel that it's our civic obligation as citizens of this country to be able to build the institutions that we have, but most importantly, to also look into the concerns of the security concerns of the civil population and the civil society actors in this country. So today's meeting will look into the relationship, the perception, the citizen perception of the institution, but also the perception of the institution about their relationship with the citizens. We'll be looking at what we can do as citizens of this country to enhance that relationship and also enhance the capacity. But finally, you realize that we are now implementing the agreement as South Sudan as a nation, and that implementation is very important. Not unless we all understand the provisions of the agreement, it will be difficult to implement. So later we'll be unpacking the agreement and be able to understand how the civil society and other stakeholders can link their responsibility to the institution of the military.
The Voluntary Task Force on Implementation of the August Agreement 2015 is a coalition of over 20 civil society organizations who came together so that they can monitor the implementation of the peace agreement and participate in the implementation of the country's peace agreement. Following up and to end our show this week is our Voices of Peace segment. Goodbye for now and join us again next week.
We want peace in South Sudan because we have had enough death. We don't want any more child of any woman dying, whether he is a man of 50 years old or a man of 40 years old or a child of one day old.
I dream of South Sudan where citizens have access to better health services, quality education, better infrastructure.
I look forward to my children staying at home peacefully, going to schools, coming back, playing with neighbors, being happy. I see them running around smiling and happy.
I dream of a very peaceful South Sudanese where we accept ourselves as really true South Sudanese. And we smile at each other wherever we go. We embrace each other and we promote our values and identities. This is the South Sudan I believe in.